Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome, everyone. Name of this class or this session is What's Love Got to Do With? Some of you already been here before, so we're going to give some ground rules about what this these classes are all about. First of all, these classes are not per se a counseling class for you to gather information to try to beat up or try to expel on your spouse. It's not that type of a class. It's a class that's developed to give you an understanding of something that I don't feel that the Lord has led me to teach about, that because most of us don't understand what marriage is. You can go up to anybody right now and ask them what marriage is, and 99% of them couldn't tell you, give you a biblical definition of what marriage actually is. So we kind of, Lord let me lead to teach this class, create this class, and kind of give people an insight and an understanding on what marriage is. The Bible tells us to, above all things, to get understanding, right? So we're going to use this as a means of developing and growth in ourselves. So if we do achieve a mate, if we do have a mate, or even in a relationship, we understand the position that person has in us, that they don't affect us to a point where we can't minister to them. You will learn as we get into this class that most of us has taken people and put them in a position where only God should have. So that's why we have a hard time when our feelings are hurt or ministering to each other. Also, I kind of like to say this too. When you walk in here, I want you to kind of dismiss all your preconceived ideas of what marriage is. I know we've been taught by our moms and our dads and even pastors and teachers and kind of gave us this perspective on ideal of what marriage is all about, but really none of it has any biblical foundation. They can tell you from a social point of view that if you get a young lady pregnant, you should get married. If this happened, then you should get married. Or they'll throw the famous word out there, better to get married than to burn. Not understanding what married is. So if you can, just drop all those preconceived ideas. I have great respect, though, for all of those parents and grandmothers that has given us these ideas. They've given us these ideas to try to strengthen us to keep our marriage together. I have great respect for them, and they're very sincere in what they are trying to teach. But unfortunately, they were sincerely wrong. They had us building up a foundation that was very shaky because it wasn't built on biblical principles. And my objective is today, in this class, in all these classes that has to deal with what marriage has to do with, to get you foundationally strong in the word as to what marriage really is and what it's all about. A while ago, the Lord kind of hit me in the head with this statement. He said, my people, he didn't just say people. He said, my people are playing these roles as husband and wife and don't even understand what the play is all about. Did you hear me? He said, my people are playing these roles as husband and wife and don't really understand what the play is all about. I said, Lord, I need to study. And as I studied, he began to lead me into certain things and show me certain things about marriage and how it is broken down into the three different categories. Well, I think, let's pray first. Let's pray, and then I'm going to show you something. Spar heads. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we come to you right now, Father God, and I ask you, Father God, in the name of Jesus, to open up the ears that everyone here may hear, and open up our eyes that we may see, and our heart that we may receive all that you have for us. But we know, Father God, that even though I stand here as a writing ready pen to relate that which you want them to hear, it is your Holy Spirit that is the ultimate teacher, Father God. So let them gather an ear attuned to the Holy Spirit, because I can say something that you can tune it just a little bit more and they will hear something different as pertaining to them, Father God. So open up their spiritual ears, Father God, their spiritual eyes, and let their heart receive all that you have in the revelation that they may achieve in this class. I ask this in the precious name of your Son, Jesus Christ, and by the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Before I really get into this, I want to show you something. Hopefully I can situate this so it can be heard also. It's that bottom red dot.
I think this is really important for everyone to hear. Our generation is obsessed with sex, whether you want to believe it or not. It's in practically every TV show, every movie, every billboard, every song. Everywhere we go, it's there. Society today glorifies it, and they see it as a good thing, and they want people to do that. The way that media has portrayed it has taken away the true meaning of what sex is. See, now, I myself am remaining a virgin until I'm married. And that turns away a lot of people, let me tell you that. If I start talking with a boy and things are heading really seriously into a direction of dating, I have to make it clear that boundaries are very, very important to me. If they don't abide and agree with those boundaries, then I can't be with them. The Bible clearly indicates sex being for, you know, husband and wife in a covenant of marriage, because it's when man and woman become most like God. That may sound a little confusing, but let me break it down for you just a little. God is of manly and womanly qualities, if you think about it. He's the protector, but he's also the nurturer. He is the fighter and the powerful one, the provider. But he's also the comforter, and he's there for us when we need him. God is of all of those qualities, and when he created us in his image, he gave some of those qualities to men, some of those qualities to women. When a man and a woman are brought together in a covenant of marriage, and they do perform the act of making love, it's just a covenant between them and God. It's just crazy thing that we were made for a special someone. God made someone special for us. And in this covenant of marriage where we just remain pure and it's about love and we come together in that and we share that moment of being like God, it's beautiful. I can't even like put it into words. And I know what you guys are thinking. Okay, Kirby, blah, blah, blah. Abstinence. But it's not about that. It's not just about, okay, I'm not allowed to have sex until I am married. That is what the Bible says, so blah, blah, blah. Yes, I do it because the Bible says that and because I love my God. But also, I love my future husband. I am in love with him, and I cannot wait to find out who he is when God reveals him to me. I mean, heck, I might have already met him. Maybe. And I always keep in mind this metaphor when I think about remaining pure for my husband. Let's use a glass of water to resemble my purity. How I want to keep my glass of water clean and pure, because when I give that to my husband to drink from, I want him to have a nice, good drink of water. Now let's say that, you know, I went around and I did stuff, I didn't abide by purity, and I gave into lust and all kinds of stuff. I just imagine that as like dirt being thrown in there, and like hair and toenails and just a bunch of gross stuff just getting mixed in with that. And I don't want to go up to my future husband and hand him that drink and say, look, I really love you, but I did all these things. Here, drink from it. I don't want to do that. I want to remain pure for my husband. I want him to see that I love him so much, and I stayed faithful throughout all of it to be with him. Well, Kirby, what about the people who have done stuff already? Well, there's this cool thing called Jesus. And when you come to him and you come to the cross and you ask for forgiveness and you truly accept him into your heart and you make the decision not to sin like that again, he works as a filtration system, and he filters out all of that dirt, all of that grime that's been in there, and he makes you a pure, clean cup of water. Now, I'm not saying, okay, well, I can go out and do all these things and God will forgive me. Yes, that's true, but think about your future spouse. Why not wait for them and give your all to them? I mean, I would really like that if my husband did that for me, so I'm going to do that for him. And a lot of people who have been faced with situations such as rape and different trials and tribulations like that, I want you to know that you are pure. You are pure at heart, and God loves you. And the reason that that happened was because sin is in the world. It's not because God doesn't love you. It's not because he wasn't there for you. It's because when there is a real enemy out there trying to fight us, trying to take us down, and he will do anything to try to make you feel less than what you are. And I'm so sorry that someone robbed you of your innocence, but they did not rob you of your purity. God has cleansed you, and he claims you as a pure, beautiful child. So I don't want you to cave into the lies and think that, oh, because that was taken away from me and I was abused in that way, that I'm not pure, that I'm not a virgin. That is not true. And I really take that kind of stuff to heart, just because I know so many victims, and I know that they think because of that they're unpure, which is so, so far from the truth. The reason that I want to stay a virgin and stay pure for my husband is because I love him and because I love God. I don't want to cave into the lust. I don't want to get caught up in the ways of this world and the fleshy desires. I want to desire God. And when he brings me my husband, then I know this is the person made for me. This is the person I want to share that kind of relationship with. I'm too young to be doing those things. I'm only 18. Even if you're not religious and you don't believe in any of this stuff that I'm saying, at least wait for someone that you really love and be careful about it. Don't do it too early. Don't do it because someone is pressuring you and they say, I love you. You know what I mean? Do it when you feel ready. And when you feel like it's the right person, it should never be forced and it should never be against your will. I strongly believe that boundaries are important. I also believe that you should have people around you that are good friends that can also keep you as accountability partners. Don't give away your heart too quickly. Give it to God. Set it in God. Don't make good decisions. Make wise decisions. Let me know your opinions down below. Please be respectful with what you say. I'm trying to be as respectful as possible with my words that I'm saying. And if you disagree, that's all right. I'm just sharing something that's near and dear to my heart that I really want you guys to know. Anyways, I know this was a really serious topic video, but I feel like the Lord has been putting it on my heart to say this for a really, really, really long time. And I know the time is now for me to say it. So here you go. I promise next week that it'll be a really funny skit video.
This young lady.
She made several very, very profound things that she really didn't give any scriptures to back it up, but we're going to do that for her.
Yes.
Those of y'all that have been with the class before, I know you heard of quite a few things in there.
Yes.
She's missing about loving God. And I'm going to say one thing about that real quick. She's missing about not doing something, getting into sex and stuff, because she love God, and she loves her husband. Well, in Ephesians, they make a strong correlation between the marriage and the church. Do you hear me?
Yes.
So as individuals in here, you're going to be presented a husband as the church that we should be getting ready for. Just like this young lady was talking about. That is the primary aspect. That love is the primary love you should have. That love for Jesus, because he's our husband. He's going to be our husband, yeah, as the church. So the same concept that applies to the marriage should apply to your life. The same order that applies to the marriage and how you develop yourself and stay pure, stay holy, and do those things should apply to your life as you prepare yourself for the marriage to Jesus. Marriage is that practice. Marriage is that example for the young people you bring into the world. So to get us all on one page, let's turn to Matthew 22:37. It's all on one page here. Understanding that the first thing we have to understand is this. Matthew 22:37.
And he replied to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Intellect.
I like to state that a little bit differently. It's the Old Testament way. It says, love the Lord all thy spirit, all thy soul, and all thy mind. Same thing. Can we please repeat that after me? Love the Lord.
Love the Lord.
All thy spirit.
All thy spirit.
All thy soul.
All thy soul.
And all thy might.
And all thy might.
This is the foundation of everything that's going to be taught in this class. Everything that I say in this class. Everything that I relate to you, the Holy Spirit will relate to me through you. It's not about what someone else is doing about your relationship, where your heart is. Because that word all, if you define that word all, it means nothing else. So if God has all your spirit, your heart, all your soul, your intellect, your emotions, and all your might, your physical ability. And I ask you this one question. What are you giving to others? What are you giving to others? Let's turn to Luke 10, 27. Because before you can relate to others, you got to love the Lord.
Right. And he replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said to him, you must answer correctly. You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live, enjoy active, blessed, endless life in the kingdom of God.
Well, we're talking about the kingdom of God. So first of all, before you can love others, you got to learn to love God. And God is going to direct you on how to love others. So this is what I say about people having their heart in the wrong place. Society has so got us mixed up in this thing. We're going to really get into love. But society has really got us so mixed up that we're putting people in positions that they should not be placed in. So we're getting dramatized when they let us down. And we want to blame God. We're getting hurt so bad that we can't do, we can't forgive, we can't be like God, because God is a forgiving God, to minister to them, because a hurting person generally hurt people. So that's why I say I'm building you up, those of you who are married, those of you who are planning on getting married, I'm building you up in yourself through this word, that you don't have a society expectation or a society definition of marriage, but you have a strong biblical word of what marriage is all about that you can stand upon.
Yes.
When you do get hurt, if it happens, you can go to the word. And when you go to the word, we have a Holy Spirit that will comfort us, strengthen us to do the things we must do to be like God. Go to Ephesians 5:1. Because this is the ultimate that all of us should be really all about. This is the basis of it all. Because if you really, I'm going to let her read it. Read this verse. Ephesians 5:1.
Therefore, be imitators of God, copy him, and follow his example, as well-beloved children. Imitate their fathers.
Be imitators of God. The greatest form of flattery is to imitate somebody. Because when you really love them, when you really love them, that's when you want to be like them. So you heard that young lady in that little video say, just man and woman come together, we're going to give a biblical definition. That's when we are most like God. We're going to find that and show it to you. By understanding that if Jesus said it, it must have weight. If Jesus directed us to it, it must be real. I'm not going to come up with these definitions off the top of my head. I'm going to show you the word, and the word is going to step us in that direction. But before we go there, let's talk about what marriage is not. So we can dispel, help you get some of these preconceived ideas out of your head. I want some participation now. Y'all gonna have to talk to me. This is not a class where I'm just gonna sit here and teach you. We're gonna teach each other. So I'm quite cool. Every last one of you out here has the Holy Spirit and can relate something back. The first type of relationship, and I will call it kind of the lowest type of relationship, marriage is not that I want us to talk about is associate.
A what?
An associate. Somebody tell me what an associate is. Anybody got a definition of an associate? Come on now. An associate.
Somebody that you just occasionally communicate with.
Can't easily communicate. That's
yeah,
good.
Not really can't even call them a friend because it's somebody that, like if I'm walking past you, we may talk for a little bit, but there's no true relationship.
That's good. Occasionally you communicate with somebody that you have no real relationship with. A good definition in a dictionary is several aspects of, but I like this one. It says to connect with someone or something with something else in one's mind. In other words, it's a mind thing. It's just somebody that you know that has passed by and they've left an impression in your mind. Say like somebody at work. They've left an impression in your mind. You just know that, hey, there's Judy. Hey, Judy, how you doing? And that's it. Just somebody who has come into your life in terms of just leaving it. That is an associate. Associate could be a little close. It could be somebody that you mingle with but have no real relationship with. And the word has something for it. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 6:14. Read 14 through 17.
Do not be unequally yoked.
Hold it right there, though. Bible tells us not to be unequally yoked. Most people take this and they're related to marriage. But at that point, if you haven't discovered you're unequally yoked, you yoked and you're talking about getting married, then you got some work to do. It shouldn't even get that far. So the unequally yoked part should come at a point of association. Go ahead.
Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers.
Why?
Do not make mismatch alliances with them or come under a different yoke with them, inconsistent with your faith. For what partnership have right living and right standing with God with iniquity and lawlessness? Or how can light have fellowship with darkness? What harmony can there be between Christ and Bela, the devil? Or what has a believer in common with an unbeliever? What agreement can there be between a temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. Even as God said, I will dwell in and with and among them and will walk in and with and among them, and I will be their God and they shall be my people.
This is why we shouldn't become yoked. This statement has been so greatly blown out of proportion, but actually it's just only referring to believers and unbelievers. I don't care who you get to know, you're going to have differences in personality. That is not being unequally yoked. Because of your differences in personality should, if you have a heart of love, challenge you to get you to know that individual even more. That differences of personality should be something that may even enhance your life. But to be unequally yoked means that you have taken up association with an unbeliever. And the word, is that the old saying we used to say, association brings on what? Simulation. So in order for you to maintain your Christianity, to stay strong in your Christianity, God don't want us to be yoking up, associating with people that are unsaved, because they can pull us away from us. But please don't take that to an extreme and understand that God will bring a more mature Christian in association with a baby Christian. Why? Especially with men, because what? Iron sharpens iron. But we haven't grasped an idea of what discipleship is. There's a movie out, a football movie. I can't think of the name of it. But anyway, the coach tells this guy, he's talking about what he can do. I can't make a coach. I can't make a coach. Coach said, yes, you can.
Facing
on top of that,
Giants.
I'm going to put some, what's that?
Facing the
Giants. Facing the Giants. On top of that, I'm going to put somebody on top of your back, and you're going to crawl this, put this person on top of your back for 50 yards. Most people use this in terms of a ministry. They will talk about, well, the guy did it. He got down there. He did something he didn't even know he could do. That wasn't the point. You focused on the wrong thing. Should have been focused on the coach, because what the coach was doing was discipling. That coach got down there on his knees with him and talked him all the way through it. Got in the dirt with him, talked him up. Instead of going 50 yards, how did he go? He went the whole 100. That's discipleship. That's the type of association that God wants to do. So sometimes you might get with a baby Christian to disciple, and you might have to get your hands a little dirty. But at the time, your hands getting dirty, God will strengthen you to strengthen another person. As he begins to develop, as he begins to grow. And one day, he's going to be where God wants him to be. Not in 50 yards, he's going to make the whole world.
You're in the end zone.
So don't blow that thing of unevenly yoked out of proportion. Because sometimes let's go to 1 Corinthians 15, 33.
If you walk around,
this is kind of addressed to what I just got to do. What?
Do not be so deceived and misled. Evil companionship, communion, associations corrupt and deprive good manners and morals and character.
The unevenly yoke or the association we should not be doing is with unsaved people that are out there that are evil, that are doing crazy stuff. Because they can end up corrupting us. Don't run from a baby Christian. Don't run from each other if the Lord brings somebody into your life that's not at the spiritual level that you are. But what are we talking about here? First of all, we're talking about what? Love the Lord.
Right.
Secondly, we're talking about what? Is association a marriage? Does this type of relationship dictate into a marriage or dictate being a marriage? Huh? Anybody think so? No. This is not a marriage. It's not a marriage in one form or fashion whatsoever. Because when you get to the point of being getting married, none of this should actually even matter. But if you over here and you see your spouse as just an associate, that's a very shallow relationship. Very shallow relationship, and you should not even. That's not one directed by God. So the first relationship that is not, let's read one more scripture. I want to get this one in too. I'm going to get this one. Let's go to Matthew 10:16. I'm going to get two more. I want you to hear these two more. Then we're going to move on to the next type of relationship. I'm talking about loving God now. And I'm talking about marriage. The foundation of it all is to love the Lord thy God with all your spirit, all your soul, and all your might. Everybody there?
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Go ahead, Nick.
Behold, I am sending you out like sheep in the midst of wolves. Be weary and wise as serpents, and be innocent, harmless, guileless, and without falsity as doves.
So you gotta be in this world, but not of this world. You got to be in this world. You're going to have all this stuff going on around you, and you got to be wise of the moves of the devil. So you don't get hung up in it. That's why you have to be very careful of your association of those who are in the world. Very careful of your association of those in the world. Let's go one more. I'm going to get this one more in. We're going to go to the next one. I'm running out of little time here. Let's go to Proverbs 13:20. We're talking about an associate relationship. It's not a marriage.
He who walks as a companion with wise men is wise.
Yeah.
But he who associates with self-confident fools is a fool himself and shall smart of it.
Do I need to explain that one? I just had to give you some word on it. I don't think I need to explain that.
No.
We're talking about associating with those that are unsaved. Wisdom comes from the Lord. So you want to get around godly people. That's who you want to associate with godly people.
Yes.
Wisdom comes from the Lord. Next type of relationship that is not a marriage is a partnership. And this is the one that tangles up a lot of marriages because they don't have a strong biblical understanding of what marriage is. So they think it's a partnership and they think everything is supposed to be 50-50. You do this, I do that. You pat me on the back, I'll pat you on the back. And that is not a marriage. That Ecclesiastes 4:9, excuse me. 4:9 through 12. Talking about partnership, it's not a marriage. It's a partnership, kind of creates an impression that from a financial point of view, even at that everything's supposed to be 50-50. When you're in a partnership, in a business, yes, everything is supposed to be how you sign the contract. It could be 50-50, 30-30, but it's based on a contract you might sign. Marriage is not based on a contract. You want to read that for us? Everybody there, say amen?
Amen.
All right.
Two are better than one because they are a good, more satisfying reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and is not able and is not another to lift him up. Again, if two lie down together, then they have warmth. But how can one be warm alone? And though a man might prevail against him who is alone, two will withstand him. A threesome cord is not quickly broken.
All right.
Threefold
cord. Man is not an island on himself. True enough, you gotta have partners in life in terms of doing stuff, in terms of achieving things in life. That's not a marriage. That last statement tell you it's not a marriage. What the last statement say?
A threefold cord is not quickly broken.
Quickly broken. Is a marriage broken? Can you break a marriage? You're going to get into this. You cannot break a marriage. A marriage is a covenant. You can't break a covenant. A marriage is a special type of covenant. We're going to get into covenants. We're going to redefine that for a lot of people that hasn't been here for a while. So a partnership outside of the marriage may be good. You might even incorporate some of the ideals of what a partnership is in the marriage. But that's going to be flexible, not the foundation. Because if you don't get flexible in that, if you don't allow it to change to 20, 80, to 30, 70, to whatever it's going to be, if you're counting it that way, if you don't allow that to change, then what's going to happen? Your 3-4 cord is going to break. Because you're basing it on the wrong foundation. Because we have in place, as I say, we have a lot of sincere people out here teaching the word. They're not teaching it in the right foundation. They're sincere, but they're sincerely wrong. Marriage is not a partnership. Yes. Everybody hear that? What are we talking about?
What are we talking about first?
Love and God.
Yes.
First of all, the first thing you pop into your mind on anything, first thing is loving God. And then God will show you how to love others. First thing is to love Him. Let nobody come in that position, put anybody before Him. when we love him, to find out how he wants us to love others, we go to his word. And in his word, we find out, based on what marriage is, you're going to understand that it's not a partnership. And you cannot use that terminology, you cannot use that ideology as a foundation to sustain your marriage, especially in these last days. So marriage is not an associate type relationship, even though you will associate with others. As I've seen, people have been married a long time, they have a tendency to even start looking alike. You know, you're with somebody a long time, sometimes you can know what they're gonna say before they say it, because association brings about simulation. But that's not what marriage is, that's just a byproduct. Marriage is not a partnership. Not even in the smallest sense to me, because a partnership involves a contract, and contracts can be broken. A partnership involves putting a demand on your partner to fulfill his part of the bargain. Marriage is not that, because what marriage is based on doesn't put a demand on your partner to fulfill anything. Because of what marriage is based on, and what marriage is, we're going to get into it, you're seeking to see what you can do for your partner. Those of you who haven't been with me before, I'm talking about love. Love doesn't ask or put in the man, love gives. I saw a few kind of wrinkled brows out there. What are you talking about? So I thought I'd throw that in there so you can kind of catch up with us. Those who've been with me for a while know what I'm talking about. So marriage is not a partnership. Here's a good one that we're going to get into. Friendship. Is marriage a friendship? Can somebody ask me that?
Nope.
Is marriage a friendship? Why is a marriage a friendship?
Because of structure. Because of structure.
Because of structure. Yep.
Get mad at your friends and walk away from them, but I suppose it didn't end in the marriage.
Can you put it to you this way? There's going to be a social picture. You want to catch five pass you have one?
That's the difference between the phileo and agape.
Phileo and agape. Can you kind of explain that for those who are not biblically or Greekly oriented?
Phileo. Relationship is continued upon doing things that please or satisfy, or that's in harmony the way other people see things or act or do. And agape is not continued upon that.
Agape, in other words, it's simple. Agape is the God kind of love.
You're the God kind of love.
You focus on God. What do we say? Love the Lord thy God. That's why marriage is not based on a friendship. Friendship has a tendency to get you emotionally locked in with people and placing them in a position in your heart that know that they shouldn't be other than God. That's why marriage is not a friendship. Can you be friends?
Sure. Yeah.
Should you be friends?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you have to be friends?
No.
Some of the most successful marriages in the world right now are arranged marriage. Matter of fact, the most successful marriage is arranged marriage. Us that has choice, the divorce rate is right around 52%, and lately it's been rising. When they don't have a choice and they've given them a spouse, arranged marriage, They turn out very good. I'm not talking about somebody walking around like sad all the time because they with somebody, but they grow in love. Divorce rate is right around 2%. So friendship is not marriage itself. Let's go to John 15:12. We're talking about what marriage is not. First of all, mostly what we're talking about is love the Lord thy God with all thy spirit, all thy soul, and all thy might. With the emphasis on that word all, that we understand that we give it all to God first. This I used to do. We do several counseling, and we had this marriage mentor thing where we count premarital counseling. And every time, I'm talking about Christians, every time we would counsel somebody, and they would have a problem. The problem is a word problem. And the main word problem is they had a piece of themselves that they wasn't giving to God. They wasn't letting God in that position. And they trying to put the demand on someone else to fulfill what only God can fulfill. 99.9% of the time, looking for satisfaction in somebody. Glory.
This is my commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you.
Keep on.
No one has greater love, no one has shown stronger affection than to lay down, give up his own life for his friends.
There you go. What this is talking about is loving one another. And in loving one another, you give up your life for your friends. So what it means, let me explain. I'm gonna kind of touch on what love is, but we're gonna expound on a little better. What this is talking about is not something you do, but something that you already are. So it doesn't matter if it's your spouse, it doesn't matter if it's your neighbor, it doesn't matter if it's your friend. This is the attitude you have because this is who you are. And we're going to explain that why this is who you are when we get into the love portion of this. So this doesn't make a marriage. This makes you as to who you are. Got the old saying about put a little pressure on somebody and you find out who they are because what's really in will come out. This is what's got to be in you. This is what you have to be. So when that pressure comes in a marriage, because it's going to come, and we're going to explain why it's going to come. It's going to come. Instead of self-destructing, what comes out is love, and you begin to nurture. You might even just have to step back and just say, Lord, turn it over to you. But it's in love. It's not out of giving up. Because you can't do it all, and you can't do it all by yourself. Sometimes you have to let people experience things for themselves so they can grow. They can't experience through you. They have to experience through themselves so they can grow. You can talk to them, blue in the face. They have to experience the certain situation themselves so they can grow. Let's go to Proverbs 17:17. Talking about friendships, not a love.
Proverbs.
Not a marriage. Proverbs 17:17.
A friend loves at all times and is born, as is a brother for adversity.
A friend loves at all times. A friend loves at all times. That's not a marriage. That's a relationship you should have with any and everybody you walk in front of, because you are love. That is who you are. You've been born again. I won't get into it too deeply because I'm going to expound on that, and I love, but the fact of the matter, you've been made a new creature. And you must get in touch with that new creature. So the Bible tells us we must renew our minds. We gotta get that old man out of our head so the new man can rise up. That's not marriage. Friendship is not marriage. Proverbs 27:17. Now I'm just giving you a foundation. What you ought to do is study this out for yourself, because there's so much more that you can glean in this Bible in terms of friendship and how it relates to being married. There's so much more in terms of associations, and it gives you an example. One of the examples we're going to teach on, or going to talk about, because the last three sessions we're going to attack something that's been greatly misinterpreted in the church and in the world, and that's covering. So we're going to get on one of those what I call do's and don'ts. Before we get on that, we're going to have that foundation of what love, that foundation of what marriage is, that foundation of covenant, before we can touch on what covenant is all about. And one of the relationships we're going to look into in terms of a good example, and this is the only married couple that made it into that Hall of Fame of faith. The only couple that made it into you got all these men in there, you got a couple of women, but you don't have the one married couple in the Hall of Fame of faith. Who is that? Man, Abraham and Sarah. Abraham. We're going to get into that relationship and build into what covering is all about. But go ahead to Proverbs 27:17. Read.
Iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend to show range and worthy purpose.
That means that we still be getting in an association with people in the church. Just back that up. That's what a friend should be. Because iron sharpens iron. And to be more specific, a strong godly woman can sharpen another strong godly woman. Only a strong godly man can sharpen another strong godly man. And you have to be in these type of relationship. You have to establish this type of friendship, because it's not a marriage. Strengthen yourself, and you don't strengthen yourself in a marriage. You are already strong, and you're ready to give in a marriage. Because if you don't have these type of relationships, I saw that we went to a church not too long ago, and the pastor made this example of that if you're an axe, and you worst sharpen, and then you come in contact with a piece of wood, and you start banging on the wood, you just dealing with the wood. What's going to happen to that axe after it chops on that wood?
It
gets dull. But we got to look at the other side. What happens to that wood?
It's weak.
It's getting chopped up. It's getting damaged. But when you put an axe to an axe and they start to do this to each other, what happens? They start sharpening each other. So this is why we have to be real careful about friendship, and friendship is not a marriage. What are we talking about first?
Lord
thy God, with all thy spirit, all thy soul, and all thy might. Give him all. And if you're giving him all, what are you giving to your friends? What are you giving to your mate? What are you giving to others? You're giving what God directs you. Not giving up yourself in terms of that which belongs to God, which is you. You can't give that which doesn't belong to you. You belong to God. But under His direction, you can do for others. And I'm going to turn this over to the deacon. So we've been talking about what marriage is not. All these different relationships we run into. And because we don't have that strong relationship with God, we kind of take them and put them out of order. And then we try to relate them to a marriage. And they're not a marriage. They have nothing to do with marriage. In marriage, you might have associates. You're going to buy product, going to be, because you're associating with each other. In marriage, there's a partnership. Yeah, you partner together, and there's going to be certain things that, that you're going to come together and want to do kind of a partner-type relationship. But the bottom line is, it's not 50-50. Bottom line is that you don't dictate to another and put a burden on someone else that this is where they have to be to fulfill that contract called a partner. And marriage is not a friendship, because sometimes you can't be that person's friend to tell them what they need to hear directed by God. And if you have them in a position where you're not giving God your all, and they're in that position of your heart where God should be, when you go there and you poke that flesh and that flesh flares up, your heart gonna just drop to the floor. Because the process of laying a seed, the word, any farmers here? You have to poke a hole in the ground and drop the seed in. Ain't no difference when you're dealing with an individual. When you go up to an individual to drop a seed in their life, you're going to have to poke a hole in that flesh and drop it. And the minute you poke a hole in that flesh, it's going to flare up. I dare you. And then the pressure, if there's something in there that hasn't came out, that pressure probably, you might hear a few choice words, you know, like, I'm made a little bit, and the hand goes up with that finger, you know what I'm talking about, the hand goes up, you know what I'm talking about, and they give you that hand with, yeah, they give you that finger, but they can give you another one too. So, marriage is not an association, marriage is not a partnership, and marriage is not a friendship. And we're going to find out what a marriage is so you can build your foundation upon that and have some biblical foundation. So society won't be dictating to you what marriage is. Your mama won't be telling you, oh, you got to stay in there for this reason, that reason. But meanwhile, you're dying inside because you have nothing really to stand on in the word and to comfort you, to take you the way you need to be. And marriage is not a friendship, because sometimes you can't be a friend to somebody when you're married. Amen?
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 Amen.
Y'all ready for Denise?
Yeah.
We have Denise's Corner Denise coming right now. Denise's Corner.
Good morning.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Well, Lord gave me a little word to bring forth today, and I'm going to bring it forth. Got a couple of things to say. I thought Michael was going to start going into it when he started talking about Abraham and Sarah. And mine is on, I'm going to talk about Sarah and what, who she is and what her position is and how that relates to the marriage. Because Sarah, you know, her name means princess, a woman of high rank for all races. But before she was Sarah, she was Sarai. And Sarai meant quarrelsome. So that to me tells me that one of the reasons why it took so long for her to have a baby, because God wanted to use her, is that he had to get her in position and get rid of all the quarrelsome. You know, God had plans for her. And so just like in our lives, you know, we're birthed, and God has plans and goals and a path for us to walk on. And so when we're not on that path, or we veer to the left or we veer to the right, you know, then we're not walking in what God has called us to do. And so Sarai means quarrelsome. So God had to get her in a position to be Sarah, which is the princess of women, high ranking. You know, she's the mother of all of us born of God. You know, she became a mother of nations, and kings came from her. So God had big plans for her, but he had to get her in the right position. And so as a wife, you know, going as a woman going into marriage, that wife has got to get in position because God has great plans for her. So it's important to understand what Sarah had to go through to get there. So if you know the story about Abraham and Sarah, Sarah, you know, she made a terrible mistake. She tried to help God, like God needed help. What was she thinking, you know? But she decided she needed, that God needed help, because surely, you know, she's reaching, she's way past what we think is old. You know, she's in her 80s, 85s now. She's like, okay, you know, God must need some help, because he done told us a plan. We believe the plan, but it ain't happening yet, you know? So God, I guess you need some help, you know, because I'm not pregnant yet. So anyway, she tried to help God. And as we know the story, that didn't work out. And so when God came in and said, okay, listen, you know, next year this time, Sarah is going to have a child. And Sarah laughed, you know, and she laughed when the Lord told Abraham that she was going to have a son. And she's like, in my old age, you know, now I'm going to have a son? So Sarah laughed, and, you know, and God wasn't that happy about it, you know, and he knew that she laughed in her heart. So God knows what's in her heart and what we, how we feel and how we react. You know, and that's what God heard in her heart. She didn't laugh out loud. No, she laughed in her heart, the Bible tells us. You know, so God knows what we're feeling, even if we don't even speak it. So, you know, but Sarah's laughter, as the story goes, turned into the laugh of amazement, triumph and delight when Isaac was born. Sarah and Abraham both, they learned more, how more fully to trust God. What Sarah learned is nothing is too hard for the Lord. God can do anything. God is not hindered by physical limits. God transcends all things, and that's why he was dogmatically stating that the appointed time, I will return to you to the time of life. So we have, now that statement, let me read it again. God transcends all things, and that's why he dogmatically stated at the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life. See, God gives us a promise, and they're set for a point of time. And so we must have enough faith in God to know and wait for the appointed time. God doesn't tell us always the appointed time. Even when we're pregnant, we don't, you know, the doctor tries to anticipate and based on a formula that when your due date is. God knows the appointed time. So even though we think we can calculate it, but it doesn't always turn out that way. You know, and I know in my pregnancy of my son, when I realized that he was supposed to be due on the 22nd, and then I count, okay, 22nd, 23rd, 24th, I said, oh Lord, I'll be in the hospital for Christmas. That's not gonna work out. You know, and so I said, Lord, that's gotta work out. I've got a 4-year-old at home. Lord, that's not gonna work out. I need to be home. And so sure enough, my son was delivered on the 17th. So I had a week, a little less, to get back home and get ready for my 4-year-old to have her Christmas. You know, so I asked the Lord that, you know, to change that due date. So God sets the appointed time, and we've got to trust God enough to know that he knows, that he knows when is the appointed time. And that's important. So, and then actually the time of life. So Sarah came to truly believe in God that he could and would do what he said he would do. And so, by faith, Sarah received strength to conceive the seed and bore a child. Why? Because she judged him faithful who had promised. So understand, I'm talking about Sarah building up her faith in God so that she trusted God. And that's what we have, that, and she's our example, that we have to learn to build our trust and faith in God so that we can go on with the things that, that are going to happen in our life, knowing that God can do all things. So what God will speak to you, he's going to bring it to pass. So Sarah's laugh became a triumph of faith in the mighty power of God. Sarah came to know that no obstacle is too hard for God to overcome. Do you have that kind of faith? One act of believing faith can have a long-lasting ramification. When Sarah finally believed God enough to trust him enough that she was allowed to conceive, the ramification is where we are now. You know, there are kings and nations that come through the line of Sarah. In fact, through that line comes King David and Jesus Christ himself. So if Sarah didn't obey and follow and trust in God, then God had to find another route to find somebody to come through in order for Jesus to come. So following God is extremely important, that we have to follow him. Not saying that there's going to be another Jesus coming through, but what comes through our line is very important for what God has planned for us to do. So we are children of promise. We are heirs with the sons of the free woman. We are free from whatever the devil throws at us. We must have faith in God as we move into the new covenant with God when we get married. Michael will talk more about covenant. But Sarah is our example to follow. And I'm mainly speaking to us women. And so women, take note of these four things a wife must do to have a godly marriage. Sarah's, her beauty is in her heart, gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. Put on submission. Be submissive to your own husband. Sarah called Abraham Lord, or master, head of household. And keep in mind that submission is not an option. It's not, well, maybe I'll do it today, and maybe not tomorrow, or when I feel like it. Submission is a command from God that we must adhere to. We also are not to respond in fear or terror. We need to respond in faith and love. This puts God in the midst of our house, and it kicks out the devil out of our house.
Can you repeat that, please?
We do not respond in fear or terror. We respond in faith and love. This puts God in the midst of our house, and it kicks the devil out of our house. Because when we respond in love, God can come in, because love is more powerful than the devil. You know, love cancels out all of the confusion, the hassle, the fussing, the fighting, and the arguing, the quarrelsome. That all gets displaced when we respond in love. So that should be our first response. When something comes against us, or there's something going on, there's some issue going on in the house, we need to respond in love. Not in anger, not in cursing, and you know, all in the flesh. Because then, because we put God in the midst so he can work through whatever issues that are going on. So we have to invite him in to help us through circumstances. And then we're supposed to obey and respect and honor our husbands. Here again, this is not a suggestion. This is a command. Now I have one other thing I'd like to read. It's a little prayer. I don't know if I did it before, but I found it in the midst and I thought I'd like to read it again. It starts out, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I am not moved by what I see. I am only moved by the word of God. I can do what God says I can do. I can say what God says I can say. And I have what God says I can have. I repent for speaking the wrong words out of my mouth. I repent for speaking wrong words concerning my spouse, our situation, our finances, and our future. I cancel the effect of negative situations, of negative words, and I put out the fire that's been ignited by my words. I abide in Christ, and his word abides in me. I can ask what I will, and it will be done for me. My words carry power and authority. Through faith-filled words, my circumstances are changing. Suddenly, things are growing and changing in the right direction. I am not a complainer or a grumbler, and I have learned to be content with what I have. As God prospers me and brings me into a new place, and I now obey every instruction from the Lord. So I am expanding my tent and making room for increase. Goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And God has taken me to the next level. So Satan, I declare to you to take your hands off my body. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Take your hands off my mind, because I have the mind of Christ. Take your hands off my spouse and my family, because they are purchased with the blood of Jesus. And take your hands off my finances, because God is increasing me and watches over me. And that concerns, and that which concerns me. Now go, ministering spirits, and cause the money to come. Go, those who are ministering for the heirs of salvation, now and cause the increase. Thank you, Father, for your increased favor in my life, favor with my spouse, favor with my family and friends, favor on my job. Thank you, God, for using me to be a blessing to someone else today. I give you all glory for causing me to grow and prosper spiritually, mentally, physically, and financially. Amen.
Can we get a copy?
I don't have nothing to say about that myself.
Well, what are we talking about here? Love the Lord thy God with all thy spirit, all thy soul, and all thy might. We're talking about love of God. We're not talking about putting other people in position where God's supposed to be. We're talking about loving God and let him show us how to love others. Next week, we're going to get deeper into, and we're going to break down this thing called marriage in terms of love, covenant, and marriage, and how it functions. And we're going to give you some strong biblical definitions, particularly on what marriage is. Show you how even Jesus directed me. It's not coming out of my head. I'll show you how Jesus directed me and showed me. And he told, not only showed me, but said it in his word that this is what marriage is. And I don't know why we just kind of passed over it in years, but the time is coming now. It's based on that young lady I just showed you, God is making himself known in terms of marriage, what he expects. Because I believe there's an end-time marriage. If you read the last chapter of Malachi, said, I'll bring love of the Father back to the children, love of children back to the Father. Sometimes because of our this society right now, we get so hung up in the masculine and the feminine, but anytime you have a father, you've got to have a mother. Yes, we always have a tendency to mention the head first or put the head out. But anytime you have a father, you've got to have a mother. So he's talking about bringing marriage. It's end time marriage situation is going to happen. Marriages and the family is going to come back together. Well, it's 8 o'clock, a little after. I appreciate you all's time. Thank you all for being here. Pastor Hill, would you like to have a word of prayer?
I think we need to.
Father, we thank you for your love. Greater love hath no man than the love that you had for us.
Yes.
You laid down your life. Lord, it was all for us. If you laid down your life for us, we ought to lay down our lives for our brother.
Yes.
Oh God, we thank you today. Your grace is sufficient.
Yes.
And you're able to make all grace to abound in every area of our lives.
Yes. Lord,
even in the area of marriage, we need more grace.
Yes.
More grace. Hallelujah. By the grace of God, yes, we can love you with all of our heart, all of our soul, and all of our might.
Yes.
Oh God. Hallelujah. You give it more grace. You give strength to the faint, to them that have no might. You increases their strength.
Yes.
They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength.
Yes.
Oh God, we might ask, how can we love one another as you loved us? Lord, it's all not of ourselves, not of works, lest men should boast. Yes, it's all because of the grace of God that you have placed within our lives. And we can do all things through Christ that strengthen us. Father, we thank you for the word of God, and even in the area of marriage. The word gives life, it gives knowledge, it gives information, it brings revelation and understanding. Love will guide and
hallelujah,
bring us, bring our hearts and our minds, hallelujah, in a place where we can experience the renewing of our minds. Father, we thank you tonight. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That your grace is sufficient. And we thank you tonight that the word of God through your vessels, and Lord, we are just instruments in your hands. We are just channels for you to work through. And it's you that worketh in us, your will and the do of your good pleasure. And Father, we yield to your direction. Lord, lead and guide and order our steps according to your word. And Father, we thank you. And as you give more and more revelation and more understanding, and as the word of God is expounded upon and shared and believed on, Lord, we will see the fruits of it. And we thank you, God, for the word of God, even tonight, and those that you are using. We give you praise and we give you glory in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. Revive!